So welcome to 28th lecture. We'll continue our discussion on time harmonic problems and the solution of diffusion equation. Now first application, we are going to see 3-4 applications of this time harmonic problems. So first we'll see calculation of eddy current losses, which is very common in many applications, and in fact in electrical machines and equipment we want to minimize eddy current. But in some other applications like heating applications, you need eddy currents, right? And then so calculation of eddy currents is important in electromagnetic devices. Now induced electric field intensity in absence of free charges is E is equal to minus dou by A by dou by T. The complete expression is minus del V minus dou by A by dou by T, is it not? But minus del V is equal to 0 because there is no charge accumulation. So charges are moving, so it is basically only currents are there, either free currents or induced currents. You understand what is meant by, you know, there are no accumulation of charges means nothing like, you know, like capacitor for example, because capacitor is like charges get accumulated. Moment charges get accumulated, you have del minus del V term. Right. But if you are considering a case in where only currents are flowing, either source current or induced currents, though there is no accumulation anywhere, charge accumulation, so del minus del V term is 0, right. So E is equal to minus dou by A by dou by T, so that is equal to minus j omega A, dou by dou by T is converted to j omega in frequency domain. So eddy current due to induced electric field will be J AD is equal to sigma E, that is minus sigma dA by dt. This we have seen earlier, in fact, in the diffusion equation it appears, is it not? So minus J omega sigma A is J AD, right. Now eddy current loss is V into I, is it not, is the loss. The corresponding J into E will be loss per unit volume, because E is volts per meter and J is ampere per meter square. So 1 upon meter and 1 upon meter square, so that is why J into A E will be loss per unit volume, right. And why here J E
complex conjugate,
because these are phasors. So always when we take product in our electrical calculation, we always take one of the quantities as
complex conjugate.
So if you substitute E as J upon sigma, J AD upon sigma, we have J AD square by sigma dx dy dz, right. This is per unit volume, we have seen that. Now we will take a very standard problem, a bar plate problem, which is a very representative problem for eddy currents. What we have is a current bar carrying suppose high current. In the vicinity there is some structural plate, mild steel. This situation appears in many electrical equipment and machines, is it not? Some current carrying conductor is close to a structural element, conducting element, and eddy currents are induced. So we are now interested in finding eddy current loss in this plate due to this current, right. So this current is going to have magnetic field, alternating magnetic field around it. That alternating magnetic field is going to induce eddy currents in this plate, and that since there is a conductivity associated with this, we are interested in finding the losses. If you are interested further in calculation of temperature rise, that also can be done. We can actually, these losses can be fed to a thermal FEM code or commercial software. There we have to give the loss per unit volume individual finite elements as the input for the thermal model, and then you will get the temperature rise. So that also is possible, but in this course we are mostly restricting ourselves to electromagnetic field calculation and the corresponding performance parameters. So we will not get into the thermal analysis. So now here one more thing that we want to remember. We are not interested in eddy current loss that is happening in this bar. So we will define sigma equal to 0 for this. So that is the, while doing FE analysis, one has to be clear what is the focus and correspondingly reduce the problem complexity, right. Here we are interested in eddy current in this plate only. So, we need not unnecessarily put sigma here, otherwise it will, you know, you will get losses in this bar also. If you are interested in losses in bar as well, then of course, you have to give conductivity for this copper bar. Suppose this is copper, then you have to define conductivity there. And then you have to worry about the skin effect and the corresponding size of element in this bar. So, that actually is the complexity. If you want to avoid that complexity, you do not define conductivity for this bar. You are then treating that bar as just the source which is producing or inducing eddy currents in this plate. But if you are interested in skin effect in the bar itself and effective AC resistance of bar, this current bar, then of course, you have to define conductivity and then take care of skin effect and the corresponding mesh size in the bar. So, that is the reason. Now, see, again we are not giving, we are going to only study part of that code which is new, right. Rest of the things will be similar. So, what we are doing, we are set in the code, we will set up a loop and then one will go through each element for each element, and if the material is 2, that is this plate, mild steel plate, then we will define mu as mu r times mu 0. Relative permeability of mild steel into mu naught, and sigma will be 1 upon this, because sigma of mild steel is taken as 7 into 10 raised to 6 Siemens per meter. So, 7 is nothing but 1 over this, right. And then if it is 1 and 3, that means either this is the this air part, right, all this air part, or bar, bar is 1 and air is 3, then it is mu naught. Here anyway it is mu naught, we have seen earlier copper also is mu naught, right, mu r is close to 1 and sigma is 0, air anyway it is 0. I just explained we are defining sigma 0 for bar also, copper bar, because we are not interested in eddy currents in this bar, okay. So, now here this is the element level coefficient matrix, this is identical, is it not? I hope you remember this expression, the element level coefficient matrix is formed just 3 by 3, 9 elements get formed only by this one, you know, statement in the code, right. And then this B is nothing but J delta by 3, okay. What is new is only this D. So, now this D we have seen here, sigma delta by 12 and this matrix, right, sigma delta by 12. So, sigma delta by 12 and this matrix. So, Sairam had explained in one of his, you know, tutorials on FEM. Matrix can be written in Scilab, a small matrix can be written just by this, first row, second row and third row separated by this semicolon. So, this is the only new line. So, when you are actually solving this diffusion problem, right, as compared to Poisson's. So, you know, you are this will be only, this will be the only line which will be new. So, see how FEM coding is straightforward and simple. If you understand simple Poisson's code, which was given, entire code was discussed and explained to you, there you have to just add this, right, and with corresponding definition of sigma and all that. Now, here we are formed at the element level. Now, global, again same thing, we first take using T matrix, we take the global node numbers, which will be second to fourth entries, because T you remember is 4 by number of elements, right, 4 by number of elements. First entry is the subdomain number and second, third, fourth entry are the global node numbers of that element, right. So, by this command, for one particular element under consideration, we are basically in nodes, we are taking three global node numbers of that element, right? And then we basically set up this again loop. This we are known by using this command, just one command, you are forming global coefficient matrix C, capital C. And then by this command, we will form the corresponding global D matrix. So, this is the BJ, that means source contribution to B. And later, after getting the final set of linear equation, you have to impose the boundary condition. If outermost here in this case, this outermost box A will be defined as 0. So, all those, you know, entries, and then that also we have seen, we have to find out those edges, and then the corresponding node numbers there, start a node and end node of each edge, and then all those nodes you define A equal to 0. So, that procedure remains same. Then what we are doing? We have got, by doing all this, forming this and imposing boundary conditions, then inverting the matrix finally, we would have got the solution, right. So, I am assuming now that we have written a code and we have got the solution. Now, this is the post processing part. So, for again going from element to element, if the element, if the subdomain number of that element, which will be the first entry, is it not, of T matrix, if that is 2, that means that what is 2? 2 is the displate where we are interested in eddy currents. So, that means if that element is inside the plate, right, then you take its global node numbers, take the corresponding nodes, x and y nodes, coordinates, x, y and y coordinates of those three global node numbers of that element which is inside the plate. In this pot variable, that means potential, you get those magnetic vector potentials, the solution that you have obtained, is it not, three values, and then take the average, that means we are taking the average potential at the centroid, right. So, and then the loss we are calculating as loss is equal to sigma delta. So, this is the formula, sigma e square dx dy dz. Now, dz here is 1 because it is a 2 dimensional approximation. So, we will be calculating per meter depth losses, right, that is why dz is 1. So, basically it is E, magnitude is omega times A, right. So, omega time, so that means omega A square, and we are calculating at the element level. So, omega A square, and this A for that element we are taking the average value, right. So, that is omega, that means this is nothing but whole this thing is magnitude of E square into sigma into dx dy is delta, the area of the element. This is omega and it is 2 pi f, right. This command will add all the losses corresponding to the elements, all the elements in that plate, and then display the loss. Is it clear? Now, this is the solution. Now, for mild steel and aluminium, now one case is the original case that we had considered. This is a mild steel plate and is a current bar, and then you have got a field. Now, can you see clearly the skin effect? And in case of aluminium, the skin depth is more, here it is something like 2.69 mm for mild steel, here the you know, it is more than 10 mm for aluminium. So, that is why you can see, can you see
one contour,
in fact is diffusing out of the aluminium, is it not, slightly diffusing out. So, the diffusion is more because skin depth is more, right. And the corresponding losses after you know, calculating fields and all that, and by following the procedure that we just now saw, the loss obtained for mild steel, magnetic steel, is 367 and for aluminium it is 76, right. And why it is low? Because it is sufficiently thick aluminum is used. If you use a very thin aluminum, this loss will be quite high. So, whenever you use aluminum or copper, the thickness should be sufficiently high. It should be at least equal to, you know, depth of penetration or skin depth, if not more, to reduce the losses in the aluminum or copper to a reasonably low value. Otherwise, there will be excessive losses in aluminum if it is very thin aluminum plate is used. So, before going further, you know, we will see what happens when aluminum plate thickness is very small. I was mentioning in the previous discussion that aluminum sheet thickness should be sufficiently there, comparable to at least skin depth, right. Now, here you can see this graph. When the aluminum this aluminum plate thickness is like less than 5 mm, then you know the loss is quite high, right. So, that is the reason that you need to have sufficient thickness of the electromagnetic shield. Now, this aluminum and copper, they are called as electromagnetic shields because they work as shield by virtue of the eddy currents induced in them and the repelling action. There are other shields which are called as magnetic shields, right. For example, if suppose this is a structural component and you want to shield it, you could just put some magnetic shield, that is high permeable magnetic material, just on this plate, on this side. So, it will take all the flux through it and will not allow to go into the structural plate which is to be shielded. So, that is type of magnetic shielding, right. So, here it is, when aluminum and copper are used, they are called as electromagnetic shields, right, because they work on the principle of eddy currents and the corresponding repelling effect of the field, right. Then let us go further. Now, we will talk of non-homogeneous Neumann boundary condition. So, this is a little advanced topic, but still I think it is important to understand because we have always been talking of homogeneous Neumann condition, is it not? Dirichlet conditions are two types. One is homogeneous, non-homogeneous. When voltage is 0, it is homogeneous Dirichlet. When voltage is non-zero, it is non-homogeneous. That is obvious. And homogeneous Neumann condition also we have seen in case of parallel plate capacitor when we neglected the fringing effectively on the vertical vertical sides of that parallel plate configuration. We discussed earlier that we have homogeneous Neumann condition. Then one may be wondering when would this non-homogeneous boundary conditions would be helpful. Right. So, let us see that application now. So, now let us see, let us start with first B is equal to del cross A, and that is why H is 1 upon mu naught del cross A in free space. Right. Now, if you expand this del cross A with A only having z component, then we will have only two components when we expand the curl, is it not? There will be only two components. This we have seen earlier. So, now this is the geometry, and suppose you want to impose non-homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions on the top and bottom. Why do you want to do that? We will see it later how that is useful, but that is equivalent to imposing HT, magnetic field intensity, on the top and bottom plates, right. HT, so constant HT on this line and constant HB on this line or surface in 3D, right. Always remember this is a 2D approximation, actually it is 3D. So, this when we are saying this top and bottom, they are actually plates in 3D, right, or surfaces. So, now if we say H is equal to HT AX on the top plate, that is the boundary condition that we are imposing, then effectively HT AX, that means in this case this has to be 0. That means daba AZ by daba X, we have to impose it at 0, is it not, effectively. Then only H will become HT AX at. So, this has to be 0. Then only this AY component will be 0, and then H you can impose as just HT AX. in x direction. So then that effectively means that you are imposing this equal to 0 on the top boundary, right? And effectively you are imposing daba az by daba ax as mu 0 times ht on the top surface. So effectively this is non-homogeneous boundary condition you are imposing, because daba az by daba y is equal to mu 0 times ht, right? And this is a non-homogeneous cut, and this is daba az by daba y, so that is a normal component here, right? Okay, so similarly h is equal to hb ax hat, and then again you know it is the same thing, only thing here this daba az by daba y will be different than this, because if ht and hb are different, these derivatives will be different as values, right? So on the bottom boundary. So now the elemental entries in this matrix capital B small b for a node R. Now we are discussing Galerkin method here, because you remember this expression that we had, you know, got when we saw Galerkin equation, and then you know we said that this is the, we in fact invoked first divergence definition and then the divergence theorem, and then we got in fact this in that derivation for you know Galerkin method under weighted residual technique, as a weighted residual technique. So this I also told here, slide 3 of lecture 22. Okay, so we had got it here. So in the process of this Galerkin's method, we get this. Now we have to, all other things remain same, because now we are imposing the boundary conditions, is it not? So these boundary conditions, how they reflect in our final set of matrix equation, that only we have to see, is it not? So now let us see what happens to this. Now we are taking so this for top edge, for example. So 1 upon mu 0 daba az by daba y is ht, and daba az by daba x is equal to 0, and an hat will be a y hat, normal to this will be a y, and d tau will be dx, because this contour will be dx. So that gives, so this expression becomes, this whole thing becomes, now this, you know, this since an hat is a y, so only this dot product will be non-zero, this dot product will be 0, so only one term will remain, this term, and that is what, one term a y hat dot a y hat, right. Now this closed integral, now we have to evaluate this. Now let us take this geometry. Now this top surface or top boundary, there may be number of, you know, elements here like this, right. So I am just drawing on this top contour, suppose there are such 1, 2, 3, 3 elements. Now we have to evaluate for each of these, you know, elements and the corresponding nodes, what would this boundary condition mean. Now we had also seen in case of weighted residual technique that we write weighted residual statement for each node. Do you remember? We in weighted residual method we go for each node. In linear formulation, if an element has three, if the element has three nodes, then there will be three weighted residual statements for each node, is it not? So this, when we do that for each node, we will get this one expression corresponding to the boundary, and then here it will be, suppose it is node 1, then this will be n1 and n1, right. So now in that case we are evaluating for node 1 this expression in the process of Galerkin's technique, and the geometry is this with 3 elements, so node 1 is here, right, this is the node 1. So now here this daba az by daba y into mu 1 upon mu 0 is ht, is it not? So this, when you substitute it there for this, you know, for node 1, so node 1 is part of now this element number 1, right? And we had already seen in that weighted residual technique, this common edges, inside common edges, they do not contribute to the that matrix, boundary matrix, is it not? Because these ANs are oppositely directed and this edge is common. So, the corresponding function is common and these ANs being opposite, they cancel. So, that is why the line integral over edges 1, 4 and 4, 2, 1, 4, 4, 2 or 2, 5 or 3, 5, all these contributions will get cancelled. Only the contributions on the boundary will remain, right. So, if we have understood this, then we are just substituting. So, what we have to evaluate? We have to evaluate only on the outermost boundary. And there we are just taking now these two segments, 1, 2 and 2, 3, right. So, now h, the closed integral for node 1 in element 1 will be ht node 2 to node 1. We are going in this direction, anti-clockwise direction. So, node 2 to node 1, n 1 1, n 1 of 1, right. And 1 upon mu 0 dabba a z by dabba y is nothing but ht. And ht is constant boundary, the value of ht on the boundary is, you are specifying it is constant. So, it comes out of the integral, right. Now, this n 1 1, this is our standard expression for n 1. Shape function, is it not? And then we are just integrating with respect to x. So, it will reduce to this into x plus y 2 minus y 3 x square by 2 into x 3 minus x 2 y x, integration with respect to x, right. And then we put the limits x 2, because this is from x 2 to x 1, because node 2 to node 1. So, x 2 to x 1. So, we just in place of x, we substitute x 1 minus x 2 here, and here y, in place of y, you can either substitute y 1 or y 2, they are same because y is constant, is it not? So, since we are talking of node 1, we have put here y 1. So, now this is what this whole integral when evaluated will reduce to this, right, and then that will effectively go into that which matrix corresponding to. So, the entry of B corresponding to node 1 in the B matrix will basically be resulting from this expression. Similarly, now for node 2, now see node 2 is common for elements 1 and element 3, node 2 is common for element 1 and element 3. So, now this expression will get evaluated for node 2 twice, one as part of element 1, one as part of element 3. Element 2, it is a part, but element 2, there will not be any contribution to the boundary because none of these edges, 3 edges of element 2 are on the boundary, clear? It is a good question, but you understood the answer? Because this element 2, all these 3 sides of this element 2, they are basically common to some two elements, is it not? And again by this logic, the contributions will get cancelled. So, for node 2 only the contributions will be from these 2. So, contributions from element 1 with respect to element 1 and element 3. So, that is what it is, element 1, element 3, n 2 1, n 2 2. Right, and ht remains same. Similarly, for node 3, it will be node 3 will be again from 3 to 2, we will evaluate for corresponding to element 3. Element 3 integral node 3 to node 2 ht integral n 3 3 dx. And similar to node 2, this element, this node 1 and node 3, they may be common to some other element, is it not? There will be some element like this here or some element like this here. So, again there will be additional contributions for node 3 from this segment here and for node 1 from this segment, which will be part of some other element, clear? So, that is how you basically evaluate and then this we have done it only for the top edge. and that too only for you know, I have shown it for 3 nodes here, but there may be more number of nodes. Although for all those nodes, these expressions will have to be evaluated, and they will go into the corresponding B, capital B, small b matrix, which is the right hand side matrix corresponding to the boundary conditions, right. And remember, this B is only from the boundary conditions. There will be some B, if there is a J existing somewhere in the domain, then there will be BJ, right. And if it is a linear formulation, if that J exists, it will go as J delta by 3 at all the respective those 3 nodes, and that will get appended to the B matrix, right. So, I think we will stop here and then we will continue the rest discussion in the subsequent lecture, okay.